Welcome back to the Football Fitness Federation podcast. This is episode 165, and I'm delighted to be joined by Angel Acena. Angel is the head rehab fitness coach at Watford, someone that I've stalked for quite a while, to be fair, on Twitter. I've not left him alone. And when he came over to the UK, I had to get him on the podcast. So, Angel, thank you very much for coming on the podcast.
Thank you. Thank you, Ben. It's a privilege for me. It's proud to share my views and my opinion about fitness in football. Well, delight for stay with you and spend this hour with you.
Perfect. Well, it's great to have you on. And I want to just go into your background a little bit to start with. So can you talk us through like the clubs you've been at, the previous roles you've had, and then also take us up and give us a little bit of information on your current role at Watford?
Yeah, of course. Well, I start my career. Obviously, I don't start in elite. I spent some years in amateur football in Spain. This is a message for all our college or the young student that finish the university degrees, and they want to start in a hurry in elite football. You know that is difficult, and so a lot of people we spend more than 8 years in amateur football, third, fourth division in Spain, and well, I have the chance in 2015. To join in Sevilla Football Club in the first team of Rehab Fitness Coach. It's through my close friend Moises de Hoyo. We spent almost three years in Sevilla Football Club. You know, we win the Europa League trophies, Super Cups, Copa del Rey. Was amazing. Was a very good experience. So after Seville, I have the opportunity to go with Costa Rica national team in World Cup in Russia. It was an amazing experience. As Rehab fitness coach and assistant fitness coach, for me, is have the opportunity to go to a World Cup with a national team. It's for me is the most top experience in my career. Obviously now in Premier League is top. World Cup is another experience, another world. And after World Cup, well, I have a brief period in Holland with Vitesse. Well, it's almost I think it's not reached to 2 months. Well, different problems, you know, my personal situation and problems with my personal situation did that I left the club and come back to Spain. And then, well, it's another experience in Qatar with Qatar Sport Club in Qatar Star League. Well, another experience is different. Obviously, the level of professionality there is much lower than top leagues. Now it's good, you know, it's a good place to stay in football because the World Cup, but in individual, if the clubs, there are a long way to do about professionalization in the football player in Qatar. And after Qatar, yes, I had another exotic experience with Zambia national team under 23 with the African Cup for the tournament for the Olympic Games in Tokyo. Well, it's another experience, African football. This is the only place that I have been working is in Oceania and Australia. So this is the only one that I need to go back. So and after this, I work in Albacete Balompié in second division, La Liga in Spain. After Albacete Badajoz, second division as well. And well, I had the opportunity to come to Premier League for Watford. You remember, is Moises de Hoyo was working in Watford last season. Álvaro Reina as well. His colleague Jordi García is my other friend that called me from come here to develop and try to help with the performance department. And well, this is now enjoying the Premier League. It's a nice league. for me is perfect.
So Angel, in terms of your roles, you've worked with obviously a lot of different squads there, from teams over in Spain to international teams to different teams in Europe, different squads in Europe. Do you think it's crucial for practitioners like yourself to go and get that experience in completely different environments?
Yeah, as I told you, and when I stay in Qatar, there are a lot of difference. For me, the main difference about the structure of the clubs, the facility of different clubs, for me is I call the invisible training or the blind training. This is the part of the life of the player, of the athlete, that is not under the supervision of the athletic trainer, coaches, and in his private life. For me, this is a big difference between top clubs, top level players, and players of club with less level. Obviously, increase the quality of the facilities, allow you to do a perfect work, do a very good training according with your mentality, with your methodology. But for me, the main difference is obviously difference in techniques, in coordinative, technique, tactics, physical. I have seen that the explosive action in top level players, peak speeds, high intensity running is higher in top players than the players that are not for top level. Even there are a lot of studies that show that total distance is not a good metric or good indicator for the performance of the player of the teams. Yes, it's, in the other hand, this is a good indicator, the high intensity running and sprint distance from difference, take a difference between top teams and not top teams. And so this is, for me, this is the main difference between.
No, that's great. And I wanted to ask as well about, because with your different experiences, what's been your initial perception or views of the Premier League in terms of the league as a whole, but also like the schedule and how it affects your role?
Yeah, for me, it's very hard league, maybe even harder than the Spanish league, La Liga. For the level of the all clubs. I think for the type of the football he's doing here, because I have seen that here the game is not finished until 90 minutes. And I have seen the games, I remember our game with against Everton, we are losing in 80 minutes, and in less than 50 minutes we score 4 goals. And so this is... Yeah. The games are going to go on retour, a lot of transitions, so direct style of play, wingers so fast, high intensity in the individual duels, one against one, two against two. Well, this is, for me, this is the spectacle of this league is higher than the Spanish league. Maybe there are less positional attacks. If you put out, for example, Manchester City, that is, I think, is another style of different style of play. But the spectacle is for this type of play, for the intensity, for a lot of transitions, the high intensity of the individual duels between players. And so this is one of the things for me is with the differential aspect for this league.
And has it meant that you've had to make many changes to your approach? So the approach you took working in Spain or Holland or even with some of the national teams that you've worked with, is there anything that you've sort of come into your role at Watford and gone, wow, I'm going to have to change this to work in the Premier League or not so much?
Well, finally, just in elite football, there are sometimes more similarities than differences. This is, at the end, you work with elite players. For me, if you put in another hand, the level of the facilities, obviously here, of course, and I think in general in the all Premier League clubs, the level of the facilities, you know, the investment of technologies, the organization of the all department, medical department, scouting, performance department, coaching staff, is higher, is top level. And so if we take in account this aspect, I think obviously, you know, with the difference with another leagues, with you know, Africa and Qatar, this says with level is very low, is different in comparison with Premier League, another different. But I think, well, maybe the similarities are the same. Now, elite football, you can see some videos in social nets, you know, for the strength training, for the individual program, for the prevention, even the fitness training on the pitch. There are a lot of similarities. I think top clubs, you can see the videos about the power strength training and focus on the power, focus on the force velocity, focus on the functional movements. If you watch the videos about the fitness training on the pitch, you can see intermittent training, working in worst case scenarios. This is, so I think there are more similarities than difference between the different clubs and teams. Yeah.
Perfect. And you touched on something there that I was going to ask next in terms of maintaining fitness throughout a season, because it's a super busy season. Obviously, a lot of stress go on to the players with the schedule, but also going away on internationals and everything else that you've got going on in the season. So if I was to ask a little bit of a broad question to start with, in terms of your philosophy, your approach on maintaining fitness and keeping players fit.
Well, when top level league starts like this one, for example, Premier League, and if you are a club that is not inside the European Cups, even in this case, when you play between 6-7 days, now we are going to play between 2 and 3 days with this congestion period in December, it's difficult, you know, it's difficult to make another prediction that is go so far that microsite or structural or tactical prediction is almost impossible in elite football. You know, all the weeks you have a peak in the load, that is the game. All the progression, or you know, all the planification of the week is depends of this game. You have to work from the last game and manage this fatigue and this recovery from the last game, and manage the optimization of the window of activation from the next game. And so for me, the most important is a good training load in the microsite. And for this reason, for me, taking account a lot of college, a lot of research, a lot of team habit, et cetera, is key to maintain this different in spikes of load between a safe range, a safe threshold. It's between 15-20% the difference above or under on training load. And so for me, this is the key. This is the key. And I always say the same, the best option or the best strategy to reduction injuries is not a good individual prevention program. It's the good monitoring, a good of training load. Because this is the key. And so how is the maintain the fitness during a session? Throw the all competitions, because really in 7 days you have only 2 days for optimization. You know, it's -4 and -3. This is the days for optimization. You can include the strength, power training, and the high intensity running distance, long distances, and so on. Maybe another third day for activation, in which you can do it, you know, take decision, pay PAP with a throw, low volume and high intensity for vertical horizontal vector, squat, thrust, etc. But really, there are only 2 trainings in which you increase a little bit the training load. So for me, in elite football, this fitness level of the player is almost throughout the competition, obviously, focusing in during the week in these 2 days in this specific aspect for power, for velocity and high intensity running.
Brilliant. Yeah, that ties into a podcast I did quite a while ago with a coach who's at Preston called Tom Little. I'm not sure if you've seen any of Tom's work, but his podcast was titled Managing the Microcycle. And that's basically what we talked about, is that because a football season is so chaotic, you've got to take charge of the microcycle and then deal with week by week what's going on, because things change, don't they? Yeah. I'm sure you've come across that already, like with what you do. Yeah. Things change at the drop of a hat. So I think it's really interesting how your role and responsibilities change with factors that are out of your control.
Yes, this is obviously, but really now in my role, you know, is more and we have fitness, and so I have intervention in some aspect for the training, but all my 98% is you know the rehab process of the player, obviously, well, individual programs and some for the recovery strategies, but this is now I'm focused more on the rehabilitation, of the reconditioning of this player, and well, this is well, you know, I have been fitness coach, the main fitness coach in the past in other clubs, and this is because I know that you can adapt or you should use your periodization, microcycle, tactical periodization, in the whole team and in the rehab process, and this is I manage the weeks and the rehab weeks with the player from the philosophy of the microcycle with the same days -4, -3, -2, -1, because this is the key. When the player return to play with the rest of the team, he need to continue with these weeks, and so for me, the best way to approach to the normal week when the player return to play is obviously in the phases when you can do it, pre-optimization, optimization, close to return to play, is periodize weeks for rehab or reconditioning from normal microcycle. Is similar for the team. And so this is how I adapt my previous role of fintnes coach or rehab fintnes coach or rehab program.
Yeah, it's really interesting. And the other part of it, obviously, is the detraining side of training and dealing with the squad, because obviously with the amount of players you're having to work with, not all the players are playing all the time. How does that factor into your philosophy and your way of working?
Yeah, this is another problem. But when you have natural weeks, you know, 7 days, it's easy because you can do it a day plus one. When one part of the team do the recovery training, the other part of the team is you can do it the threshold what you think. But in my case, in the past, I always use more than 60 minutes and less than 60 minutes to do the top-up session or the compensatory session for the non-starter players and the players who start and who do the recover. But the problem is when you have a congestion period like now, in which you have 3 days between games, two days between games, and so in these cases, the top-ups, you have to focus a short top-ups after the game immediately, because if not, it's impossible, because you don't know which of these players who are doing the top-up, even if you choose, for example, you play on Sunday, in our case, you play on Sunday and we play Wednesday again. If you do a big top-up in Monday, you don't know if this player, one of these players who is going to play on Wednesday, and it's 1 day less for recover. Obviously, it's not the game. Obviously, I always say the same. There is no session that achieves, in general, the exigence, emotional, physical, psychological for the game. This is, but well, you can do it a good top up with a lot of sprint, high intensity running. That this is the action, the metrics that demand a lot of fatigue in the player. And maybe if you do too much more, and you have less than two days for the next game. And so this is difficult. It's difficult to manage this situation when you have a lot of competition in short periods. This is a challenge that all fitness coaches in the elite clubs have to take the decision how can fight about the training of the player, because you know the rotation is the ideal situation, but sometimes you can rotate. You have 13, 14 players, you have another 5-6 players that play too low a few minutes, and so this is the problem. How to keep, not how to recover the player, because you know, as we're speaking about the last question, is not the player who is playing all the weekends maintains the fitness more or less. This is, but how what happened with the player who play 1 weekend 10 minutes and the next weekend nothing and the next? This is the challenge for keep the fitness state and avoid the training of these players. And well, this is normal weeks, good top ups, focus on the different aspects. Obviously, no forget the power, forget the training, and no forget obviously for the high intensity running, sprint distance. At the end, is the for the prevention and for the performance and the competition.
Yeah, brilliant. I suppose that ties into something that you've already spoke about. Well, firstly, in terms of like taking advantage of any free time or times that you can sort of expose players, isn't it? Well, then that also ties in with what you spoke about before in terms of, again, managing that microcycle and dealing with things on a weekly or probably not even a weekly level sometimes, just from game to game.
Excuse me, Ben, what are you asking me about?
Yeah, so I was just saying that, just to sort of summarize on that point, two things that stand out for me is, one, trying to take advantage of any time you have available. So you were talking about top-ups, you were talking about working after games. So those times are crucial, aren't they? Because they're the times that you've got exposure, you can expose players. But also, the other side of that is what we spoke about before, is that has to come with managing a small period like the micro cycle, because that you have to adapt to whatever you've got available, really.
This is the for me is the most difficult. This, because sometimes the ideal situation, you know, this is to the top up now. But you manage if some of this one is doing the top up now is going to play in the next game, and if we have a short time, it's very difficult. I remember when I was working in Albacete in second division La Liga, it was immediately after lockdown, and we play between 2-3 days no more, and it was I remember 12 games. And this was this problem was we think about how is the best way to do it. If we do a top up immediately, obviously it's difficult because you know if someone who has experience in football knows that a top up after a game, immediately after the game, the best option is without ball. This is obviously always the ball is more specific after a game. The best option is without ball and focus on the high speed running, sprint running, change of direction, and this is an intermittent. But this is you put out the specific aspect of the football, one of the aspects of the ball, but this is the only way to do a good top up immediately after the game. If you wait for the next game, maybe you have enough time to recover for the next game. And so I have thought a lot of time about it. Finally, always think the same. Try to, you know, is go directly for the most important at this moment, because after a game you have 20-25 minutes, no more, to make a short top up for this player, focus on the high speed running and sprint. Maybe next day, if you have 7 days, you can complete with a little bit more distance, something on the strength, small side games for acceleration, but if you have 2-3 days, maybe the next day is focus a little bit in another aspect and prepare the next game.
Brilliant. And yeah. Angel, I couldn't get you on with, because I know your role now, you've mentioned, is a little bit more rehab based. So in the previous episode, I brought up a topic and a question, and I think it'll be really good for you to tackle as well. So the question is, when you're going through a rehab process, which one of these is your primary goal? Is it to get the player back as quick as possible, or is it to get the player back in the best condition possible? And I know there might not be one answer or the other, but a really interesting, I just thought it'd be interesting to get your point of view on this one.
Yeah, this is a good question, but always when I have to do a conference or master's degrees, etc., I always speak about my, it's a decalogue, it's a list of 10 items that for me is important. And one of these is, in rehab process, the best rehabilitation process is not the quickest, if not, is this rehab process that you have not to repeat 2 times, you know?
Yeah, this is, yeah, exactly.
And so for me, the balance is not go to in a rush, okay? It's because, you know, the healing process, the healing of the tissues is the biological process. We can do miracles about this. You can use PRP. There are some research that says that it's good for healing, but not for accelerate a little bit. It's not. And so in football, you know, we have a temptation for get the medals when we are, and you know, the stars here in this spectacular, the football player. In our case, I always say the same. I try to help, but I have to disturb the less, at least. And so for me, is complete the rehab process. And this is include the healing, a biological process, repair for the tissues, complete different phases for the rehab program, the injury phase, rehabilitation with the orientation approach, reconditioning for pre-optimization, optimization, and return to play, return to train, return to competition, return to performance. You know, you get the backtalk studies and now the different focus of the rehab. For me, this is, and so if I have the balance between go quick and complete a rehab program, for me it's complete a rehab program and take being sure with a return to play test that the player minimal is ready to train with the team. Then we need to complete the training load, adapt to the weekly normal schedule for the rest of the team. And but for me, this is sometimes, you know, ACLs, why the all ACL is in 6 months. We have seen a lot of research being Hewitt, and they show that between 12 and 24 months is the period of ligamentation of the plastia with ACL. So why 6 months? Obviously, in 6 months, the football player can change of direction, can take the ball, it's normal. But the risk of the re-injury is high. If we speak about hamstring injury, now why 3-4 weeks? Now there are a lot of studies that show that minimal 6 weeks. Depend. Is different hamstring is proximal distal. Is different if it's myofascial or affect to the tendon. Is different, obviously. But in general, for me, I prefer complete the whole rehab program with the whole phases, a good screening for the KPIs or criteria for advance for one stage to other stage, and finally good return to play test to being sure that this player is okay for join now the rest of the session with the team. So this is my mentality. I prefer. For the reason I haven't got any medals for going with. No, I prefer this is my mentality. So
no, it's brilliant. It's a great perspective on that. And I think it's just an interesting question, but I suppose it brings up the conversation around who, because at certain clubs, I'm sure that will be fine. The process will sort of be left to whoever's in charge of that rehab process. And it'll be on someone like yourself to say, this player is ready to train, this player is ready to play. But yeah. I know at other clubs, there's going to be other influences where managers are going to be a little bit pushy and be like, is he ready? Are they ready? Are they ready? And maybe that is when players are put into competition too early. And that is unfortunately when we see re-injuries happen, isn't it? So I appreciate everything you said then. I think it's spot on. But I know that there are other factors, aren't there, with some clubs?
Because I think, Ben, that with this question, we have in all clubs the tendency to compare different, compare the same injury in different players. And this is a big mistake. Yeah. Because this not, it's not, I don't work, or I don't, I not rehab injured. I rehab a player or even a person or an athlete with a punctual problem. And so when you put the same injury in different athletes or different person, it's different process, different injury is different. I have seen this year two collateral medials of the knee. One player is one thing, and with another player is also absolutely different thing. It's the same club, the same year. And you feel with one player is different, and with other, and it's the same structure, it's the same injury in theory, and this is, and so we can't compare the same theory injury in different player because it's totally different. This is.
No, it's brilliant. Great point that. And I just think it's really important for people to hear, especially from someone like yourself. Angel, we always finish the podcast with some, I always call them quick fire, but they don't have to be that quick in terms of the responses. Just three questions that I finish every podcast with. It'd be interesting to get your answers on these. But the first one being, who are some of the biggest influences on your career so far?
Well, yes, I remember in terms of fitness, you know, the mirror of another fitness coach for me, Paco Segrulo, one of these one for the biggest name, Juan José González Vadillo for the strength training, was one another who is, and now with another colleague who is, I think his work is amazing. You know, I spoke about Moises de Hoyo, is now in Villarreal. This is, for me, is one of the tops, brilliant fitness coach. He was my mentor in the past. He called me in the past for Sevilla Football Club, and you know, in the professional and the research. So this for me is this are one of the person who is the biggest names in the fitness in the fitness profession. You know, now I know that we have a very good. I love and try to get everything for the all college. I have very good relationships with the all college. I try to learn everything for everyone. Here this year with Jordi Garcia, the first time I learned a lot of, he's a top professional. Now with Carlo, he's fitness coach of Claudio, he's a very good fitness coach. I'm trying to learn different things. Well, I think we are in our profession, we are around with a very good professional, and I always try to learn for everyone.
And that's the best way, isn't it? Being a sponge and literally listening and learning from everyone. The next one is, what would you say your biggest strength is as a practitioner?
Oh, it's my biggest.
Your biggest strength. So in terms of like your best skill or attribute.
Well, you know, I have improved my connection with the player, my emotional aspect. I think in the last years, when you increase your experience, because, you know, the research knowledge, it's normal. You when you work in top level, you have to, you know, in my case, I teach in a lot of master degrees, conference. You have to keep your update. You must be update every day or every week for the new research, everything. But I think my big improvement in this last year is about the emotional and psychological aspect. You know, I think finally you work with person, and this is the contact, the connection with the player, trying to, you know, get him good self-confidence, manage this aspect, you know. And so for me, I think that I have improved in this aspect a lot. This is
it's a great point, that, and it's something that a lot of people have talked about before on the podcast, because it's fine having the knowledge, isn't it? But if you don't have that connection with players, it doesn't really matter.
This is sometimes I tell sometimes we are focused on the laptop, on the data, and we don't look for the eyes of the player. And sometimes we need look look to the face and feel the sensation, and look less for the laptop, half of the information. That is important, obviously, but
it tells you a lot, that, doesn't it? Having that conversation with someone, looking in their eyes, it tells you a lot.
This is
brilliant. And then just the final one is, what is your approach to, I always ask about CPD, so it's like continued professional development, but in terms of just like growing as a practitioner, improving day on day, like, what's your approach to that? Is it reading articles? Is it certain podcasts? Is it certain websites? Is it what? How do you improve?
Really, reading about or listening about everything. Now, I think, for example, if I focus only in rehab now, I think the rest of the, I'm going to lose a lot of things about the other things. And so I'll try to top is different aspects. Obviously, the rehab is important. Now, when you have in rehab process, you have to read research about this injury in specific, because it's normal. But a podcast for you know, and now I and this relate with this aspect about emotional connection, psychological. I have to reading. I have to feeling a little bit about this aspect, because I think is the most important. I think with the if you are being able to connect with the player, even with the, you know, with the, it's not worse work, but you can get this confidence with the player in higher way. And so this is I try to feed a different aspect. And obviously, you know, for me, training, strength training, rehab process, prevention, monitoring training load. Well, this is the topics that I usually try to read, listen podcasts, etc. This is
brilliant. Angel, this has been superb. I really appreciate you coming on the podcast. I know you use Twitter quite a bit. Is that right?
Your
Twitter, for anyone that's not following you already, is that probably the best place for people to sort of keep an eye on what you've got going on, your work, or would you direct them somewhere else?
Well, this is for now, for summarize a little bit for the, you know, for these podcasts.
Say that again, sorry.
Yes. What? So yeah, I a little bit.
Angel, if people wanted to drop you a message or if they wanted to get in contact with you, would Twitter be the best place?
Yeah, for sure. It's okay. I always, a lot of times we receive a lot of messages, and so it's no problem for me. I try to respond as soon as possible, but it's perfect. You can include in the podcast my Twitter profile.
Yeah.
Perfect. It's perfect.
No problem. Yeah, I'll just give it everyone now. So if you want to give Angel a follow, he's at @ACEA_NGEL. So go and give him a follow. I know you post loads of great information up on Twitter. So I encourage everyone to go and give you a follow over on Twitter. And I'm sure a lot of people are already. But I really appreciate you giving up your time. And it's great to finally get you on the podcast. And it's also great to have you in the Premier League as well, I've got to say. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Yes, for me it was very short. I can see the time now. It was for me only 10 minutes, but I enjoyed it a lot. I'm here, but whatever you want, I'm any available, I'm free. But for the second part or what do you need?
Let's do it. 100%.
Thank you.
Thank you, mate.